folks. Dagan here from PMTVUK. Today I have the pleasure of going through one of my guitar heroes' gear. The one and only Steve Jones from the Sex Pistols. The gear reused, why he used it, and how you can get that sound today. I've waited for years, for absolute years, to do this rig rundown. Steve Jones is my guitar hero. Angus Young and Steve Jones were the reason I picked up guitar. It wasn't until later on I discovered Eddie Van Halen and stuff, but Steve Jones was the guy that made guitar playing fun for me. And with the new Pistol documentary coming out, and literally because it's the Queen's Platinum Jubilee this weekend when we're filming this, I thought I should do a Steve Jones gear guy, because Sex Pistols are going to probably have a massive resurgence again, even though they never should have left. And I'm very giddy, very, very giddy about this. God Save the Queen came out in, what was it, the Queen's Silver Jubilee? Yeah, 77, the Silver Jubilee. They followed the Queen down the River Thames in London, playing that song, blasting that song. And now, in 2022, it's the Platinum Jubilee. And yeah, to celebrate, let's talk about all the cool stuff that Steve Jones has played over the years. It is quite a simple gear guide and how to sound like it, but it's gonna be a lot of fun. We'll talk about some expensive guitars and some expensive amplifiers, and I'm going to show you how to get that sound on a bit of a budget. So let's get into it. The first thing I want to say is the fact that there's lots of, well, not even mystery. It's just Steve Jones likes to take the piss over who recorded what and did what on Never Mind the Bollocks. Steve did everything. He just likes to say that Chris Spedding did it all. He said that Chris Spedding was behind the stage at the first few shows playing guitar, and Steve just mimed. That's just Steve having a bit of laugh. Now, the album itself, Never Mind the Bollocks, it's a hard sound to recreate because the whole crack with that album was there was lots of layers of guitar, and Steve loved the Fender Twin Reverb back in the day, which was famously stolen from backstage at the Hammersmith Apollo from Bob Marley and the Wailers, or David Bowie, but I think it was Bob Marley and the Wailers. So he used this and it was cranked up to 10. Quite a thin, bright sound. The treble has to be quite up when you want to do Jonesy stuff, the bass quite down and the mid quite high because it cuts a lot. And that is quite brittle to the ear unless you add a lot of layers to it like Steve did on the album. So it's a hard thing to recreate the album. I'll talk about the live sound later on in this video. With that, if you want to comment anything down below and add anything or take anything away or expand on anything I talk about, please comment down below and share the love, okay? You might notice I haven't got a Fender Twin Reverb. I'm in an active music store right now, and I had a Fender Twin ready to go, and it's sold. So I've got this Super Reverb. Steve did use these on tour when there wasn't a Twin Reverb available. So it's kind of the right thing. I'm using the Tone Master. So this is a digital solid state Fender amplifier, but it's the best thing on the planet for getting this tone because it's got an attenuator on the back. I've got this dialed down to 0.5 of a watt and I've got it cranked, and it is still quite loud. You can do this with a Twin Reverb as well, but if you were to crank an actual Fender Twin Reverb from the 70s up, the windows of even your neighbor's house would explode. So check out the new Super Reverb amps from Fender, Super Reverb, the Tone Master amps, because they've got a built-in attenuator. What's a good, the best thing to talk about is probably Anarchy in the UK. So everyone knows that riff, and on the album, that is the key. There's also overdubs of, down to that F, E as well. When you put all that together, you get that really thick wall of sound. It's not just one guitar, there's lots of layers of the guitar as well. And Steve played bass on the album as well, because Sid was it? I think Sid played bass on Bodies, and there was a bit of something there in God Save the Queen, but Sid didn't really do much because Sid was Sid. But yeah, that's how to get the tone layer, lots of twin reverbs on top of each other, if you have the chance to. So the case of this, I've got down to 0.5 of a watt. The volume's on 10, because when you turn it down, it is just a Fender amplifier. When you crank it, you get that beautiful kind of saturation which would normally blow the windows out. He only ever used one pedal back in the day. These days he's been seen with a full-tone plimsoll and other kind of boost pedals to boost for solos, but a lot of the time he just boosts his solo, boosts the signal for solos by the sound guy at the back. So he's playing the riff. There's no kind of boost on stage room, it's all done by the sound guy. But the only pedal he used, I'm just gonna take my shoes off right now, because I wore my special socks for today, was a phaser, an MXR phaser. Now this is where the lore comes in. Is it a phase 45? Is it a phase 90? I'm using the phase 95, because there's a phase 45 and a phase 90 built in, which you can switch between. And that's where, just over, say 9 o'clock, you get the. That's famously the only pedal you ever used back in the day. And again, because there's so many layers on Anarchy in the UK, the phaser sound is kind of fighting with itself, and there's different phases happening through left and right. It wasn't recorded in stereo, it was actually recorded in mono and just duplicated either side. So the phase is a hard thing to replicate unless you've got loads of layers of the same phase happening at once. Now let's talk about the style. Steve famously couldn't really play guitar when the band first started, and he just grafted at it and learned how to play guitar. So it's a lot of power chords. There's not a lot of intricate. That kind of stuff, it's all very. Occasionally there might be a D. Like in Submission and yeah. But no crazy kind of. It's a lot of. Let the amp do the work. And you've got to throw in a slide in there as well, haven't you? And again, a lot of the solos are that kind of double stop, not double stop, like. Like I've seen videos, he's very proud of his Never Mind his Anarchy in the UK solos, the whole. And the. He says he loves the intro in New York, because. Big solo for him back then. With all that though, I never guessed how it was claimed he sucked at guitar, but the EMI riff, EMI is my favourite Sex Pistols song. That whole kind of, get close up with the fingers there. It's the whole kind of. Got kind of. Bring your fingers over each other, and I think that's a nice example of not knowing how to play guitar, but you've got an idea in your head. Like, that's not a conventional way to play chords. So that's just another testament to how awesome the man, the myth, the legend, the Steve Jones is. Now let's get to what I still consider to be the elephant in the room. Les Paul Custom. You have to get a Les Paul Custom if you want to look, feel, and sound like Steve Jones. He's had many over the years. He's played lots of guitars like Firebirds, SGs, Les Paul Juniors, Double Cuts. But the white Les Paul Custom is just the Jonesy guitar, isn't it? And I could have used a regular Gibson Les Paul Custom, but I kindly phoned my friends at Gibson and said, have you got one of my dream guitars in stock? Because I'm going to do a Sex Pistols video. This is one of the... How many did they make? Not a lot. Less than 1,000 of these amazing Steve Jones Customs in 2008. And it's a faithful recreation of his 1974 Les Paul Custom. Any Les Paul Custom will do. I've just sold my Gibson Les Paul Custom, and this feels pretty much the same. It's just when you catch yourself in a reflection, you're like, I look so cool right now. So any Les Paul Custom will do. I'm going to play some Epiphones in a second as well to show you what they sound like differently, but story behind his custom. And it was actually Sylvain from the New York Dolls. His guitar, he put the stickers on it and stuff, and I think there was there a Bigsby? No, there wasn't a Bigsby. There was pictures of Sylvain back in the day playing this guitar. Malcolm McLaren got it off Sylvain and brought it back to the UK. I think he promised him a place on the Sex Pistols if he gave him this guitar. Steve got the guitar, and it's now mostly associated, well, very much associated with Steve Jones. It is just a straight up mahogany body, one piece mahogany body, and this mahogany neck, ebony board, Gibson 498T, 496R in the neck. You've got the pinup girls, pickup covers off, no poker chip. It's just, again, it's a Les Paul custom, so any will do, but when you see yourself in a reflection, like there's a camera above the screen right there, and I'm just so happy I'm playing this guitar right now. So, Les Paul Custom, Fender amplifier, absolutely cranked to get the main sound, but let's, if you can't afford this ridiculous guitar, let's try and see what the Epiphones sound like through the Super Reverb before we move on to the Marshalls he played on in later years. Actually, let's firstly play a riff on the Jonesy Custom and then move over to the Epiphone. Instantly feel that the pickups aren't as hot, but the challenge pretty much there. You can change pickups, can't you? But you can't change the look, and a Les Paul Custom is a Les Paul Custom. This is an Epiphone inspired by Gibson Les Paul Custom, one of the new ones. It's just a joy to play. See if I can do the whole. Yep, the vibe's definitely there. The neck's a bit thinner because not, well, Les Paul Custom necks are quite chunky, especially when it's inspired from an early 70s Les Paul Custom. So these are a bit more forgiving. They fit a lot more genres and a lot more styles, because not everyone likes a Les Paul custom neck, but this is a very versatile neck. Fun little fact, little tidbit that I should have mentioned when I was talking about that guitar. Never Mind the Bollocks wasn't recorded on that guitar. It was recorded on a 1957 Les Paul Custom, which was black and actually had a P90 in the bridge and one of the cool P90 staple pickups in the neck. That's what the album was actually recorded on. So it looked more like that than like that. That's a fun little fact for you. So let's see how it sounds with a cranked Fender and some P90s. I know this SG Special is a lot thinner than a 57 Les Paul Custom, but P90 sounds like a P90. It's got that nice kind of brittle mid-range poke that we all love about it. And he was known to frequent a SG every now and then. That's quite bright, isn't it? Sounds like a P90 through a crank Fender. When you play Pistols riffs, it sounds like the bloody Pistols. Later on in his career, though, he moved away from the Fender amplifiers in favour of some gorgeous Marshalls. More specifically, the JCM 800. I don't know if they were modified or if they weren't modified. Also, he used the Plexis as well. Everyone knows them for the Plexis. Again, I don't know if they were modified or not. But the 800 was seen a lot in later years, as was the DSL and the TSL. We'll talk about them later. Let's plug in the 800 to see what the Pistols sound like with all these guitars I've just been playing. So he started using the Marshalls, the Plexis, and the 800s later on in his career, and you also will see him with Bernie guitars. He had an endorsement deal with Bernie way years before this came out. This was in the 90s and stuff. So you will see the Bernie on the headstock. Bernie's a Japanese company which make copies of Gibsons. Essentially, they've got some pinup girls on, but you'll notice the pinup girls are sometimes different, not the same as his original guitar. I think Steve doesn't actually know where his original guitar is. Oh no, he does. Some lass in Hawaii has it, I think. But he doesn't want it back because he doesn't really give a shit about how much he's got as replica, so why would he care about the original from a lass who wants crazy money for it? So this is a lot easier to get a better sound at a lower volume. This is the JCM SC20, the Studio Classic. So it's a 20-watt JCM 800 with a low power and a high power, so you can use it attenuated. But even this attenuated is really loud, but you can really kind of... Nice and quiet if you want with that. Again, the middle and the treble are up and the bass is a little bit further down, but it's all personal preference. He wasn't very crucial about what he was doing with his amps and stuff. It was all just, could he get a guitar to sound like a guitar? And could he go... Apologies, I'm not playing lots of stuff off Mercy, by the way. Mercy's one of my favourite albums of all time, but I think a lot of people just want to hear Pistols riffs, I guess. So that's the 800. Try it with the Epiphone now, because later on in his career, when he was using the Marshalls, he rarely used the P90s. That was just for the original 70s chat. So let's try the Epiphone with a Marshall. Try to play the same riff again and again so you can understand how the differences sound between these guitars, and that is the Marshall JCM with the Epiphone. But if the Marshall is still a bit too pricey for you, there is the DSL. Marshall's DSL range are the more affordable all-valve amplifiers, dual-channel. They used to do the TSL, which was exactly the same, but it was three channels, and he's been seen a lot using the TSLs back in the day. I think these days he still uses the JSM 800s, but let's plug a DSL in and see what that sounds like. I started off with No Feelings because that's a really good example of if you watch live at the Brixton Academy. Obviously that's the only thing happening at the start is Steve's guitar. Really hear how much grit he's got on these days. It's went from like a bright multiple Fender Twins to a really kind of crunchy, gainy. It still works with the old stuff as well. He's actually using the TSL in the video where, what I religiously watched as a child, where he teaches you how to play the riffs and he thinks it's ridiculous. But there's a TSL in the background when he's going. He's actually playing a Bernie in that as well. That's where he famously says, Sex Pistols stuff's easy, Buddy Holly could have written some stuff over that. Let's hear it with the Epiphone now. So settings wise on the amp, the gain is at 10 o'clock. Because this amp has a lot of gain and too much for Steve Jones, Sex Pistols. So it's at 10 o'clock. The bass middle treble's pretty much at 1 o'clock. The presence is at 9 o'clock, the resonance is at 10. There's a little bit of reverb on this amp as well, so the reverb's quite nice. This is the most affordable way to get a Steve Jones tone in. It's literally a Les Paul into a Marshall. So that, ladies and gents, is some history on Steve Jones's guitars, the amps he used throughout his career, how to get the sound on Never Mind the Bollocks, get a studio engineer and lots of fancy double track stuff. A Les Paul with P90s in if you want to get that tone, but humbuckers for everything else, then that is it. Let me know down below in the comments what you thought of this little rig rundown. Anything else you want to add or change? Because again, there's a lot of conflicting interest out there because Steve likes to take the piss. But I've had so much fun doing this video. If you made this far into it, thank you for watching. Guitar, Fizz 45 pedal or Fizz 95 and a Marshall or a Fender Twin or Super Reverb Deluxe. And you're pretty much there. Let me know what you think down below in the comments. And if you like this video, give it a thumbs up and subscribe to PMTVUK here on YouTube for lots more cool guitar and music-related content. If you want any more information on any of the products I spoke about here today, besides that, because that was a special little something-something from Gibson, a regular Les Paul does just feel the same though, so just get some stickers and take the humbucker covers off and you're there. Everything's linked in the description box down below. It'll take you to pmtonline.co.uk where you can check out them all or call into your local PMT store and try some out for yourselves and have so much fun going. If you play Sex Pistols in a store where I'm at, I will immediately come over and want to jam with you. That is the best way to get me to jam with you. We're PMT House of Rock on Facebook, Instagram, Twitter, and TikTok. Give us a like and a follow to see pictures of these with nice filters on. I've been Dagan, and I'll see you next time.